So a couple of people asked me about this thing. Not too many, but a couple. So I'm going to explain it. It's, as you may guess, not the most elegant piece of circuitry, but I threw it together quickly with what I had on hand, and obviously some mistakes were made. So basically what's happening, pins 2 through 9, digital 2 through 9, are driving the base of these transistors, just standard NPN transistors. I happen to use 2222s because I had them. I had 100 of them. Through a series resistor on the base side, just to limit the current a little bit, because these things don't need to drive crazy hard, and we don't need to overdraw from the Arduino pins. I only built this thing in the last week or so, and I can't remember the values of all the components here. So those series resistors, just for anybody who's curious, 2.2K. Because, like I said, I don't need to drive it very hard at all. And just because somebody will ask, probably, those current limiting resistors on the LEDs are 470 ohm. So I was limiting the current fairly hard, just because I thought I was going to run this thing off batteries. And initially I thought it would just be these two boards. My big mistake in this design was thinking that I could source current from these PCF8574s, but I can't. If we take a look at the data sheet for the PCF8574, we see that if you're pulling low, if you're sinking current, in other words, you can sink up to 50 milliamps per pin. If you're sourcing, though, it just doesn't want to do that. Negligible amounts of current, 4 milliamps. So that's, and that was my big design mistake, which caused me to have to add on the breadboard and make this thing all carried away, is that I had set it up initially as if it was sourcing current rather than sinking. Oops. So once I realized that mistake, then I had to take the outputs from these things, the 16 outputs. I'm actually only using 15 because I've got 15 columns here. So I had to take these 15 outputs, bring them over onto a breadboard, and put the same base resistors in as I have up here, 2.2K, and these are, and then 15 more NPN transistors, again 2222, but reasonably, I could have used anything. I just happened to have 100 of these, so why not? And then those across to the ribbon cables. The ribbon cables are about the most elegant part of this, actually. And those just came out of an old IDE cable. But it's really nice and slick when you want to do this. So my original plan, like I said, was to just have these two boards sandwiched together back to back, and with a lot shorter wires, and then it could almost be portable. Obviously this thing can't do that. What I could have done is completely redone this so that the cathodes, the negative side of the LED, were facing the pins here, and then it could have sunk 50 milliamps quite easily. And I think these I have set for just over 1.5 or 2 milliamps, so I could easily drive a whole column off one of those pins if I was sinking current through it. Live and learn. So I could have unsoldered all these LEDs, flipped them around, blah blah blah. Nope. Not going to do that. That's nasty. Also, I could have just started over again with another batch of LEDs. 8 times 15 LEDs. No, I didn't have that many in stock. I had enough to do this and a few left over, but I couldn't do that in time. Obviously, I couldn't order them from China in time. So there we go. So that's the basics of the hardware. Actually, this board, while I'm thinking of it, so this board is, I use two different kinds of boards, actually. This one over here is just standard perf board with a little copper ring around each one. This one is a knockoff of Vero board, which the guys in Europe and UK, is UK still Europe? Let's go with it. Will be familiar with this because this stuff's been fairly popular over there for a very long time. I read about it when I was a kid in some of the magazines, but I never saw it in any of the North American sources that I had access to at the time. And this, like I said, is just a knockoff from China. Basically, it's just got long strips here, and then you break the strips any place that you don't want continuity horizontally. So along there, I ran a little hacksaw and broke the continuity. And then every second pad here, I used a little drill bit, this one back here. And actually, if I'm thinking of it when I'm editing this, I'll put in a little bit of footage of me doing that just over top of this. But basically, you just break the copper trace. And then I had little sets of pads here that I could put my rows and my columns. The columns are just bridged up in midair like that. So that took me couple of days of soldering just to put that together. The hardest part was getting all these LEDs more or less straight in their columns and rows and whatnot. The actual soldering wasn't too bad. It was just the finesse of being neat, because I'm just not used to being neat, as you can probably tell from the back of this other board. On here I started off using bits of Cat 5 cable just as my jumpers, but that quickly became obvious that I was going to start crashing into each other. So then I moved to this 30 gauge wire wrap wire that I got in a mailbag a while back. I was originally bought that intending to use it for bodge wires and stuff, but for this, for point to point wiring, it works really well. And yeah, this little wiring harness that comes down here onto a set of pin headers worked out pretty nicely too, I must say. And that again, that looks almost, well, compared to the rest of it, it looks relatively relatively professional-ish. So I think that's all that there is to the hardware, really. So these two chips here, the PCF chips, I think I discussed them a little bit in the mailbag a few weeks back, but basically they take an I2C serial in from the Arduino or whatever and break that out into 16 in discrete digital I/O pins. You can write to them, you can read to them. There's a few different ways of doing it. There's a library. I didn't use the library. I used a different method. And all you have to do is give each one its own I2C address. And you do that by jumpering certain pins high or low, and that I did that. I just soldered them permanently so that they're different addresses, and then I talked to them in software. Let's quickly look at that on the datasheet too. So here is the here's the pinout of the chip. Pins 1, 2, and 3 are address 0, 1, and 2. So with all three of them pulled low, you get an address of hex 20. And then you got basically three bits of binary. You can add to that, pull A0 up, you get hex 21, 22, so you've got seven different addresses you can play with anyways. It says pull-up resistors aren't needed. I pulled them hard to high or low just to force it, just because. So the rest of this now, P0 through P7, are the 8 digital IOs. Did I say 16 before? There's 8 on each chip, times 2 chips, because I needed 15. There's 8 on each chip, P0 through P7. And again, there's a couple of ways of addressing, of talking to those. You can use a library. I used a slightly clunkier method, but it seemed simpler in my head at the time. And what else? SCL and SDA, there's your I2C. There's an interrupt pin, which I didn't use, VCC and ground. It's fairly straightforward to use, actually. So here is one of the test sketches that I did. We start off with just the address of the two chips, 20 and 21. 21, I have the first address pin pulled high and the other two pulled low. This one, I have all three of them pulled low. I just set my digital pins for the rows, and I use that in some of my testing, but not all of it. I got a little goofy later on. Actually, no, here we go. So in my setup, again, this is just a test sketch. This isn't the one that you saw running. So set those digital pins as outputs. And here I turned some of them on, some of them off, just for testing. And then wire begin. Wire is the I2C library, among other things, but that's what I'm using it for here. And then I set up a loop from 2 to 9, which is digital pin 2 to digital pin 9. Completely ignoring that I'd set this up earlier. Yes, I know people who know how to code are going to be laughing at me. I can accept that. Wire begin transmission to the address of PCF1, which is the first one of the PCF chips, and it's got the first 8 columns on it. And so this is the hexadecimal representation of an 8-bit binary number. So that's 01. So that'll basically light up column 1, and only column 1, because in binary it is 000001, right? And then a delay that I got set up here that I kept changing that when I was tinkering with it, 100 milliseconds at the moment. And then I rewrite it and I put in just hex 02, which is binary 000010. So basically, as I'm doing this, and then 4, and then 8, I'm basically just scrolling the columns along, turning one LED on at a time, and all the way through the first 8, and then I turn all of them off, and then I go on to the second PCF, which is the 9th through 15th column, and I do exactly the same thing. Then I hit my loop, and I increment that. So here's what that test sketch does. The loop turns on one row, and then it scans across the columns using brute force. And then the loop bangs down to the next one all the way across. I just use this to test my hardware to make sure everything worked. And it does. This is the ugly code that I wrote. The fancy-er code. I tossed this upstairs to my kid and told him, you've got 2 days, make this work. And here's what he came up with. Hopefully I can explain it. So let's see now, what's he done? He has kept some of what I had, because that's what I gave to him. And I'm not sure whether he deleted everything that was completely ugly or unnecessary, but whatever. He's actually not the most comfortable in C. He's more comfortable in Java and a few other languages. Anyways, so we initiate the pins again, set up a delay. So he has set up this array here, this Boolean array, which I don't understand, basically showing where all the red pixels are in the array. So there's 3 columns there and 3 columns there, and then the maple leaf out the middle, and everything that's not red is obviously white. Pin modes, that's the same. He decided he didn't need that. He has created a function called thick sweep. Okay. This must be the scroll up and down function. I don't know what he's doing. Anybody who knows how to code can look at this and figure it out. I think I'll put it up, put a link to it in my, in the description for anybody who actually cares to look at this stuff directly. And then he's also created a function called red and white, which lights up the red and white alternating. And 0 through 7, I'm guessing that's the, rows, and 0 through 14 is the columns. So only light the reds. And he's scanning that quickly, and then, yeah, because you have to keep scanning it, I guess, to address one pixel at a time. That's another flaw, actually, in the hardware. I've got 2 different types of LEDs all conglomerated together, so I can't light up an entire row because the voltage and therefore the current handle and the current demand of the white LEDs is different than the red LEDs. So anytime there was a red LED on, it would clamp the current or clamp the voltage lower than what the white LEDs needed. So he's had to go through here and address each pixel individually and do it really, really fast. Increment the timer and then invert the flag, basically, which should be the invert of that, which will only light the white pixels, and back and forth and back and forth. And then in the main loop, he does red and white for a while, consults the timer, and then does thick sweep up and then back down again and back to that. And so here it is without the filter on it. When I shot this for Canada Day, I put the filter on it just to get a bit more contrast. And I also turned down the bench lights so that my camera would change its frames per second so that you wouldn't see all that flickeriness. Which is why it looked a little bit like that. But that changed the contrast of the overall space and made it look like, as Drex said, I had 3 Biro vision going on here. Which actually I didn't. I was on call, so there was no beer involved, sadly. Anyway, it was an interesting experiment. That red really does help with the contrast, even though there's a flickeriness. And that's enough of that. So for those who are wondering, that's what that thing is and how it works. I'm not sure what I'm going to do from here on. I may reuse this thing just because it addresses rows and columns so neatly. But anyway, yeah. And I'll probably repurpose all this stuff off the breadboard back into my parts bin for later. And this will be a reminder. Actually, even just not lit, it makes a pretty good little Canadian flag, doesn't it? I think so. Well, thanks for watching. I will talk to you later. Oh, for those who are wondering, juice of the oats, oatmeal stout. Very nice. Talk to you later. Bye.